All right, in this example, I'm going to do some hypothesis testing, specifically two-sample hypothesis testing. We're going to do two different problems, one up top and one down on the bottom. This video will just take care of this first one. The key thing about this first one is that we have dependent data. So maybe I'll even write that somewhere. Dependent data. I'll talk a little bit about that. What that means, and then I'll talk about what independent data means, which will be our next example down in number two, which will be on a different video. So, okay, if you read this question, it says that we have all this data here. If you want to follow along, you can type all this into a calculator. I know you can't see it all. There's the rest of it. I guess you could pause this and type in all those values. But once you got those all typed in, you go and read the question. It says, suppose that all this data was collected from 30 boxers measuring the power of their right hand against the power of their left hand. In other words, this is one boxer right here up top, and he got a score of 100 with his right and 90 with his left. This is another boxer who got 50 with each hand. And I claim that the boxers are more powerful with their right. I want to test that claim with 95% confidence, and I want to use the p-value method. Okay? Okay, so I guess the first thing is knowing how to recognize you have dependent data. The idea with dependent data is whenever you have two samples and an observation in the second sample is determined every time you get an observation in the first sample, you have dependent data. So what I mean by this is once I picked a boxer and put his right hand here, I automatically had to put his left here. And I picked another boxer, put his right here, his left had to go here, which you'll see is in the second example, that's not the case. Anyways, we have dependent data. So what you do with dependent data is really you don't want to do two sample testing. You want to do one sample testing. And the way you do one sample testing is by making a third column. So maybe I'll even write that. Create a right minus left column. And then test that. What I mean by test that is just you do a t-test, you'll just have one set of data without sigma population standard deviation, so you can do a t-test like we've been doing, and kind of treat it like a chapter 10 problem in our book. So the way you can do that, you put all your data into lists here. I went ahead and did that ahead of time because it seemed like it would take a long time for me to do it, and I didn't want you to have to watch me doing it, but I got my right in L1 and my left in L2. And then what you want to do is create a third list that has the differences. So 100 minus 10, maybe I can even write 100 minus 90, the difference would be 10. 50 minus 50, the difference would be 0, and so on. So I want to create a left minus right column like I started doing over here. And you can do that. With this data, it wouldn't be that bad. You can do all the subtraction and then type all those in. But with some data, it would be a pain to do that. So there's a way your calculator can do it. What you do with your calculator is you go up and you highlight L3, so you press the up key here, so it says L3 equals. And then I want L3 to be L1 minus L2. So I'll just hit L1, second and then 1, minus L2, second and then 2. Now it says list 3, that's just list 1 minus list 2. If you hit enter, it'll populate that entire list. And so there we go, now in L3, oh man, okay, I can fix that. I think this was supposed to be a 70, not a 7. I'll just fix that real quick. And then 70 minus 50 should have been 20. I guess I should have checked a little bit more carefully to make sure I didn't have any other typos. But I think we're good. So, okay, you don't have that issue as long as you didn't screw up like I did. When you go and calculate L3, or tell your calculator to come up with L3, it'll give you all these values. And then what you have is values that you can do a t-test on. So really, from this point forward, I'm just going to do a t-test. My null, I guess I'd start by stating my null and alternative hypotheses. My null hypothesis is always, it used to be mu equals mu naught. Now it's going to be mu with a little d next to it for mu of the difference, because this is kind of my difference column. And I want that to equal to mu naught. But mu naught in this case, in all of these problems in our class, will be equal to 0. Because my null hypothesis is that the two hands are the same. And if they're the same, when you do one minus the other, you're left with 0. My alternative hypothesis in this case would be mu sub d is greater than 0. The reason why is my claim here is that boxers are more powerful with their right. So I'm saying that right is more than left. So when I do right minus left, I should get a positive number. I should get the difference is greater than 0 here. And then if we knew the shape center spread, we could draw a picture and come up with our conclusion. shape is going to be approximately normal, because that's all we can deal with in our class. The reason this one is approximately normal is because n is greater than or equal to 30. You might wonder what n is. You might wonder if it's 30 or 60, because we really have 60 observations here. It's just 30 because we're testing this column, and this column has 30 observations in it. So really my value, maybe I can even write that over here. N is equal to 30, and alpha is equal to 0.05, 1 minus my level of confidence, which was given as 95%. And then for the center, we got a formula for it. We want the spread of d bar being the difference of our samples. And the way you can calculate that is it's just S sub D over N. In other words, it's the standard deviation from this column divided by the square root of N, sorry. And you could go ahead and calculate that, but I don't even care that you calculate that. I think you can leave it just like that. We could calculate that. Our calculator will give us S sub D, and you can divide it by the square root of N. Shoot, that's the spread, not the center. I wrote that on the wrong line. Sigma sub D bar is supposed to be equal to S over root N. The center, really what we would like for the center is to use mu sub D. However, we don't know mu sub D. That's something we're talking about in this problem. So what we're going to use is mu naught sub D. Kind of looks weird. We have two different subscripts. Whatever, that's fine. It's always equal to zero in these problems. Mu naught sub D is equal to zero because we're kind of claiming that the difference between these two are just zero. It's because it's the same as this zero right here. So once you have that, you can draw your picture and make your conclusion. Maybe I should switch colors. So I want to draw something that's approximately normally distributed. It's not too bad. And I want the center to be zero. And the spread is whatever this is, S over root N, which I haven't calculated, but I could calculate because I have data. And then what I can do here is if I hit the stat button, then go over to tests and do a t-test. Just one sample t-test. We're not doing anything two sample up here in number one. All I have to do is tell it that I have data that mu naught sub d is equal to zero. That's this first input here. The list I want to calculate or do my test on is L3 that had the differences in it. Frequency, that's just a default. Leave that at one. And then my alternative hypothesis is that mu d is greater than zero. So I'm going to say greater than. And then I can either do calculate or draw. Either way, they'll give you your test statistic and your p-value. Very slowly, apparently. Eventually, when this finishes drawing, what it will do is give me the picture I want down here, and I'll be able to make my conclusion. What I'm going to do is look for the p-value that eventually comes out of this and compare that to alpha. Again, alpha was 0.05. And if that p-value is less than alpha, which it is here, then I can reject my null hypothesis. So let's draw this picture. I'd kind of like to see the other statistics. So I'm going to go back to tests, t-test, and I'm going to hit calculate instead of draw because I want to see all the information they give me. It gives me this test statistic. This was on the last one, 3.7. And that corresponds with an average difference. This is really D bar is 14.3. So these are kind of X values and these are Z values. And the P value, the area above this, is really, really small. It's this number. This is scientific notation, so it's saying move the decimal place 4 places to the left. So really it's 0 point. And let's see if I move it to the left, I'd have 3 zeros. And then 498, maybe I should have just called that 5, oops, can't say 5 and write 8. So there's my p-value, this really, really small number, and so for my conclusion, I just say because my p-value is less than alpha, p-value is tiny, alpha is 0.05, there is sufficient evidence to reject my null hypothesis. And conclude. Kind of whatever the claim was. In this case, my claim was that boxers were more powerful with their right. And conclude that boxers are more powerful with their right. Good enough. So that's all you need to know when you have dependent data. Really, it's just a t-test. It's the same thing we were doing in the last chapter. It kind of feels like it should be two sample testing, but it's not. It's just one sample testing because you make one set of data here by subtracting these two guys. So then you just follow all the steps we did before when we had one sample, when we were doing one sample testing. And here's what you got. If you really want to calculate the spread, for example, here's S, so 21.445. And you could divide that by the square root of 30 in here and get these numbers. But really, that just tells you how spread out we are in our picture here. This top row of values was the actual differences. So this is saying that on average, my rights were 14.3, whatever this unit is, more, which is 3.7 standard deviations above the mean. So that's kind of the interpretation of this picture. There's the p-value, and that is the end of this example. In the next one, I'll talk about if this data were a little bit different if it were independent data.